am Mansi Sharma, welcoming you all once again to yet another episode of Media Minds Season 2, an IndianTelevision.com initiative where we try to delve deeper into the modern marketing world by discussing some of the latest trends, technologies, and their own journeys with some of the leading marketers, advertisers, and publishers. Today, we have with us Mr. Vikram Sakhuja, who is currently the Group CEO of Madison Media and OOH at Madison World, and has had an extensive experience of over 3 decades of working in the industry, both on client side and on the agency side. He has been a trailblazer, bringing some of the concepts like agency on record to India. Today, we'll be talking to him about his journey, what he envisions for himself and for his company in the coming days, and some of the latest trends. We welcome you, Vikram, and thank you so much for taking time out of your schedule for us.
Oh, my pleasure. It's always a pleasure to talk to you.
So you are just about to complete 5 years at Madison. I guess in October, you will be completing the tenure. When you had started at Madison, you had two broad pieces of agenda in your mind. That is to increase the effectiveness of the campaigns and involve better into internal agency management. So how much have you succeeded in both the realms? How has your experience been?
Oh, wow. Okay. You remember all these things. It's dangerous to talk to journalists. You remember things. You've got a long memory. You know, the effectiveness, this piece about effectiveness, making it more important than efficiency, is an ongoing process. And yes, I think we've made some strides in that. So yeah, actually, if I have to look over the last 4.5 odd years, the few things that I feel good about are, one is we've instituted what we call outcomes planning. It's basically each agency has its own planning framework. So we had our own one that we drafted out, and then I sort of rolled out through the agency. Is marketing taken forward in the area of deployment of budgets? We see some pretty wide traction right through the agency. And I think we've seen some pretty good results with clients as well. So I would say, yes, there's been some satisfaction when I look back and I say this outcomes planning, which is all about effectiveness. By the very definition, outcomes is effectiveness, is something that we've driven quite well. Second thing, which I believe we've sort of moved up forward on, is the entire concept of integrated teams across Madison World. So across the 30 plus years of Madison's existence, we've got some 11 very credible practices. So there's traditional media, there's digital, there's out of home, there's activation, there is rural, there is entertainment, there is sports, there is retail, there's PR, there's creative. And, end of day, there is a analytics. So there was a bunch of very, very credible practices that we had. So when people used to come in and say that, how do we get growth and all, I had a very simple philosophy. I said, listen, something called leaky bucket. I said, how much of your client's marketing budget do you think you really handle? And people would turn around and say, we are the agency of record, so we do 100%. As I think again, and suddenly you'd find, oh, it so happens that we don't do outdoors for this particular client. Another one, we went and said, looks like we are doing this, we're not doing digital, or maybe we're doing digital, but we're not doing performance. And like that, there were a bunch of things that we actually felt were actually, the client was actually giving the business to other people. So I said, if we've got really credible practices, it's a tremendous amount of value that we can give to the client. If there's a one-stop shop that can seamlessly deliver an integrated product. So we really put a lot of focus on this. And I think over the last three and a half odd years of the 4.5, 5, we've seen some pretty good movements on that front. The third one I'd like to call out was, I think, our entire digital renaissance. I would be the first to admit that probably we were a little behind the curve when we started off with on digital. So even in terms of our share of billings, it was maybe about 2-3% at the time when we started. Now it is closer to 15 to 20. So it's really grown very well. And not only that, we've actually grown our practices within that. So whether it is the entire, the display, whether it's social display, which is video and banners, social, search, the entire programmatic piece, the aspect of performance. Each of these practices has actually grown. Even then content and creative, the entire organic SEO influencer piece, each one of these practices has actually now got a very kosher representation. So I would say the digital renaissance has been, again, quite pleasing. And the fourth one, we've always had it. This has been Madison's strength forever. We had analytics, which used to be the very heart of how we used to make our strategies. So that analytics practice has actually now scaled up much more. And we've put in a fair amount of automation into also the planning and analytics that we do. So yes, if I have to look at this game, at least from the effectiveness part that your question is all about, I think we really built around outcomes planning, the entire digital piece and analytics and automation. And I think the internal agency management, we've done a fair amount of integrated team working. And that's what you're really seeing sort of on display now.
You have mentioned that digital and data have been two of the most strongest parts of your journey here, something that have propelled the group. And you have been extensively talking about the role of data in marketing, specifically in out-of-home as well. My question to you is, what makes involving data into the marketing process it a more feasible, more viable business to involve in?
Let me talk data from a couple of lenses. I think one, when it comes to media, there's an entire measurement of what we do. So measurement of audiences, viewership, things like that. Now, clearly there is nobody's going to argue that you need proper data for basically running the business that we do, the media business. I happen to believe that you have a currency in when it comes to measurement of a particular audience, measurement or viewership or listenership or whatever else it might be. It actually legitimizes and grows that entire business. So in the 1990s, when we, you know, that was the first, there was a, I remember there used to be the diary, IMRB diary. And then after that, we moved to both the TAM and the in-TAM people meters. And then from there, of course, it just moved to one TAM. And then now, of course, there's Bark. The reality is when you started measuring viewership, it gave rise to a currency called cost per rating point. And the entire TV industry just exploded on the back of that because it brought a simple metric for trading eyeballs. So similarly, I think in today's truly multimedia world where so many mediums are vying for the budget, we need more industry ratified metrics for, say, for example, measuring online video, for measuring the entire display piece, the out-of-home piece for that matter. So I think right now it's a little patchy. You've got a few areas where the currencies like in print and in TV, but in number of the other cases, radio is there, but people are really not using it that much. But when it comes to the rest, whether it's online or out of home, especially online, which is now 23-24% of the entire ADEX, I think you do need currencies. And I believe that when these currencies come, the actual market is going to grow. So that is one part. The second part is using data to make marketing decisions. I actually believe the data, to your question, or does it stunt creativity? It depends entirely on how data is used. You can use data to stimulate creativity, or you can use data as a crutch. And if you use data as a crutch, then you clearly are stunting creativity. So goes back when I was in market research, and I was in my days of Ariel and Procter & Gamble. We were launching Ariel. I was in the core team. We did some research and extensive research, and that showed that 76% of the women washing clothes, I still remember this number, 76% of women washing clothes would soak their clothes first in a powder and then use a bar to scrub it. Now, while everybody probably knew this, quantifying it, and it was so preponderant, this data was used to launch Ariel, which promised a new gold standard of cleaning with the powder without having to use a bar. Now, that I thought was creativity at its best, and it was a total hot button, and the trial just shot through the thing. And this is stuff, we were getting into Hindustan Lever terrain at that point in time without any kind of credentials in detergents. And everybody knew it was right under their nose. but it took data and somebody to see the data and then see the possibility of the data to come out with a new concept, which actually was a total, as you called it, those is hot button. Now, even today, for example, in the measurement, about a year back, Bach came out with issuing the pay and FTA data separately. Otherwise, it used to be all together. Straight away, there was a hypothesis, but the minute we got that data, it became evident that we were really talking about now two viewing TV universes in India, which is reminiscent of the old Doordarshan terrestrial versus cable and satellite days. So in the late 90s and early 2000s, we used to make two kinds of plans. One was terrestrial and one was CNS. And terrestrial was only Doordarshan and CNS was that point in time, was all the Zs and stars and whatever. Now we find that in a totally different avatar, you have a situation where just by being able to read pay and FTA data separately, you find that obviously the FTA data, people are only by definition only able to see FTA and it's actually booming out there. But amongst the pay homes, FTA probably has less attraction. So it allows you to come out and spend your money entirely differently and very creatively. The problem happens when you use it as a crutch. So if I want to make a decision and then if my decision is made up and I use data to support that, that I think is a loser's game. And I see that happening enough times, but I think a lot of the stalwarts in the entire industry will tell you that that's the part which they actually do a very good job of breaking down those kind of issues when people actually use data as a crutch. So if you ever see that being done, break it down. Otherwise, it's a liberating force.
As you have already mentioned that a metric system of some of the good data initiatives that are already there, but yes, it's lacking for digital, it's lacking for out-of-home services. So how early do you think the industry will be able to adapt and adopt a new unified metric system, which were earlier the peripheries of marketing, but now are an integral part of the whole core marketing mix for any brand? Digital and out-of-home included. Out-of-home was already included into the core marketing mix, but digital, yeah, surely. Does it need more?
Today, we are in a situation where on online, the larger players are actually coming out with their own logs and they say you have to pay as per that. And when you come out with some third-party measurement, which is also very sort of kosher, and there's a big difference, and sometimes the difference is anything 10%, 30% at times, those things are being refuted. Now, that is ridiculous, according to me. Now, I think you've got to, which is where if you come out, and this is right now I'm talking about just monitoring. The same thing applies to viewership. I remember the very first time when just about the YouTube was starting, and I remember the very, very first time an IPL was coming on online. I think it was, if I'm not mistaken, YouTube was showing it. And there were two sets of data. At that time, I think one of the measurement systems, I think at IMRB was doing WAM in those days, web audience measurement, and they were piloting it. And we got some data on viewership of IPL from a third-party system, and we got data from YouTube, and the two were totally different. And obviously, and the YouTube one was much higher. Now, reality out here is you need to build credibility. And these days, we are hearing so much of, you know, viewership, and you know that all these companies, nobody's going to be give outright. They're all companies with integrity, so they won't be outright white lies, but there'll be shades of gray. So you don't know what the viewability metrics being used are. Was it above the fold, below the fold? How many seconds? How many pixels were on screen? All those kind of things. Now that so happens when you have a third-party system in place. It follows a certain code, and it tells you actually that this is a qualified sort of impression and therefore the reach that comes from it and so on and so forth. Now, you don't want to be in a situation where you're putting money out there and you're slightly dodgy about did the viewership happen or not, or what exactly was my total reach when I took the full plan. All of us in agencies are trying to approximate, and we've got our own technologies to do that. But if you had one seamless system which actually did that, the entire industry would grow. And I think, frankly, I would put right now the ball in the advertiser's court, and I'd say it's your money. If you put down your foot and say that if there is not an industry measurement on this, I am not going to advertise on these platforms because I can't use your data to pay you. I think that is going to be a very firm step. And I think the media owners will be forced. In fact, everybody, media owners, agencies, everybody will have then the urgency sort of thrusted down their throats. And then we might do something about it. So I would right now say that advertisers wield a lot of power. They should, even right now, in a totally different context, we're all reading these days about the entire Facebook piece and how some of the American and global advertisers, they have a certain point of view on the entire inability or lack of sense of purpose with which Facebook has managed the sort of hate speech and the other kind of speech. And as a result, they decided to pull out. Now, you hear all the activists and say the activists are saying that we've been trying to do this for the longest time ever. But the minute an advertiser, a big advertiser, puts his foot down on this, they're forced to come to the table and talk. So, I think advertisers wield a lot of clout. And if they start using it on this important aspect of third-party measurement, I think there'll be a lot that we can do.
As you mentioned about Facebook and advertisers pulling money, I guess it's not just about Facebook or on digital platforms. This whole debate of the validity of a media platform has also, transited into the traditional media too. Be it a news channel taking a certain political standing, same with the newspapers. So where does this whole relationship of the agency, the brand, the advertiser, and the media publisher is going to evolve in the future? How are advertisers looking at it? The risks of being associated with any of the media platforms right now?
This is a very, very interesting question. I think it's got to be answered in two ways, from a what's good for the brand standpoint, and another one is a higher order ethics debate.
Yeah.
From a brand standpoint, again, it goes back to my P&G days. Really, which according to me, that's the one institute of classical marketing. So in those days, we used to have a quantity versus quality debate. I'm talking about late 80s, early 90s, where people would come in and say that where your ad is being seen, is that how important is that? So, I don't know whether you guys remember, but at the time when news channel and I think Aaj Tak came in 10 years later, late 90s, everybody used to come back and say that in Aaj Tak, all you see is these underwear banyan ads. And is that environment good for our kind of brands? Now, in that kind of, right now I'm going completely off context, I'll come to the question that you said. But the quantity versus quality debate was that is the environment in which your ad coming going to does it have a role to play? And the school of Procter marketing that time told me is, look, you're targeting the consumer. If the consumer is seeing a particular programming, they're there for a particular reason. And if they see your ad, so is your consumer seeing the ad? So this shouldn't be a problem. So in the case of P&G in the early 90s, quantity was always more important than quality. For me, it doesn't matter that much what the nature of the content is, provided my right audience is seeing it, because then when they see the ad, the right job is happening. That was then. Now the thing is that maybe TV advertising still follows the same syntax. So there's a programming and there's an interruption and then there's an ad break that starts. So maybe those principles can apply to TV. But the minute you start looking now, for example, you take Facebook. There's a news feed happening. And within that, seamlessly, there is the one post coming and it's being followed by another kind of an ad. And that ad also is with the kind of entire, very correctly, I think the way Facebook is doing, they have algorithms which actually make your brands also seem like good content. So at that point in time, it doesn't seem that there's been an ad break and an ad has come in.
Yes.
So there to suddenly have, and also we know on top of that there is some amount of algorithms which is feeding people some of the content which they expected to see. So there is a self-fulfilling prophecy in the kind of ways in which some of these social media platforms are actually working. So they feed you back the same content that you'd like to see. In this environment, to suddenly say that, you know, it becomes this entire debate of quantity versus quality gets blurred. Because now suddenly I may not want to have my brand post right above or below a very sort of inflammatory or a post that goes against my principles. And then the role of content and is becoming a little important. How 25, 30 years later, it is actually very important to actually raise this question, even from a brand health standpoint. From a larger ethics standpoint, it is also that, you know, some of this, and this is not only a social media thing, it is also just about every aspect of media is right now sensationalizing to pander. And the more you sensationalize, the more eyeballs you get. So at this point in time, at a larger ethics level, do you want to cater and do you want to sort of promote this kind of sensationalism, maybe fake news and all of that? And even though it has maybe nothing to do with the brand ad that is placed next to it, finally, the reason they're sensationalizing is because advertisers are going to come because of more eyeballs, and that's how they get money. So if you take an ethical position on that and saying, I will not, even if the eyeballs come there, I will not pander to that kind of sensationalism. I will, in fact, dry up the oxygen in that room rather than give them more oxygen. Then you're actually disincentivizing those same publishers from actually trying to take that strategy to monetize their business. But that's a larger ethical debate. I don't see too many people really embracing that quite as well. So, which is where I am actually, as an observer, finding this entire debate, the way it's playing out in the US, quite fascinating. And I think there are a few people who are truly putting their money where their mouth is. And they are actually saying that just because we don't feel it is the right thing to do, we will now not advertise, even though it may be short-term bad for our brands.
That's from an advertiser point of view completely. As an agency, what do you suggest? What's the right way to go about
this? On the former, we'll have a very clear point of view on what's good for the brand. So if, for example, there are certain environments where, for example, if my post, you know, these days there is advertising and then there's content, right? So quite often there is branded content that's coming in, which in the environments where the rest of the content and your content is actually very, very contiguous, it's almost seamless. So we have to be very careful that we do not choose the wrong environment for that branded content, and in some cases even the ad itself. So there we will be very, very mindful and actually make sure that we are in properly safe environments. The larger piece of saying that, would we as an agency come back and say, whatever publisher XYZ we believe is being very inflammatory and they're using a lot of fake news to get more eyeballs? Frankly, that one is the reality is they're getting proper eyeballs, and these people actually buy consumer products. So we may present a point of view, but we would actually bow down to the client. We will make the client aware of this, that this is a situation. Now, where do you stand on this? You can be getting some very valuable audiences at a reasonably efficient price where your message stuff can be done well. But yes, there is a ethical larger debate of saying that maybe that entire publisher is fanning the flames in a very gratuitous manner, and do you want to be part of that? So there I would really listen to what the client's ideology on that is.
Also, another thing that's happening in India, and I guess in the US to a certain extent right now, is a lot of nationalistic feelings being touched upon by the government or even by some of the companies out there. When you're working in such an environment, which is getting a certain tone and is heading into a certain direction. Recently, we saw that TikTok got banned, which was taking one of the biggest part of the digital media chunks for most of the brands. So as an agency, how do you see the future panning out when it comes to marketing in India?
So let's go issue by issue. TikTok example. Now, I think there is the issue out there, at least a purported issue out there, is data security. Now, this is data, and as you're going to digital, and with digital, the data inherent in there is becoming a very valuable and a very sensitive topic. So question out here is that, you know, that is it okay for at this point in time for your data for the people of India to be residing outside the country? Now that is a, you know, that is a global debate which is right now on, and people are taking a lot of positions on that. And most of the companies, I don't think there's a single company that has not come back and tried to reassure the stakeholders that their data is safe.
Yeah.
But I think that is so, I think everybody is in agreement. Look, I think right now the problem really blew out of proportion, I think, in the last, you know, American election, when it was so felt that an outside country was actually influencing some of the voters in the US with obviously data that had reached them in some way or the other. Now, that is symptomatic of the larger problem. So at this point in time, if this data of ours is going to another country, tomorrow can they run some kind of propaganda, whatever be their motives? Now, if that is an issue, I think that it's a grave issue which needs to be addressed. And I think the tech guys are fantastic at this. And I think it's right now the onus is on them, and I'm sure they would be doing it, to reassure all the governments and the stakeholders that the data is safe. If I don't even think one of them would say it, and I don't think they should, that the data is going outside and residing outside and can be used outside. If there is any of that, then there's a problem. So first point is, in this particular case, is the data issue. So I think data security is something that is important, and it must be sort of respected. The second part is a more jingoistic or a more trying to fan the nationalistic fervor. On the nationalistic fervor piece, my own sense is that, you know, finally the consumers are going to decide. And there are a lot of multinational companies in India which are actually treated pretty much like Indian companies. The brands which they've launched are as Indian as any other brand. There are some brands, these MNCs have launched, which are only Indian brands. And in fact, they started in India and then moved maybe to some of the other countries. I don't think they will be impacted at all. So because end of day, the consumer is the one who's going to be the sort of decider on this one.
Now, moving on to a completely different topic, because very serious here about some of the broader perspectives, the social economy part. Coming back to the whole and sole core of marketing right now, I've been talking about out of home, which is a big part of your food business at Madison World. I believe it was already on a downward slope, losing popularity slowly, and with COVID, it just suddenly got to zero. Now, do you think it's the right time, the right opportunity for out-of-home players to maybe re-strategize how they are working, re-strategize how they are connecting to the consumers as well as the advertisers, and sort of begin with a new approach? Or is it going to be difficult for them to get up from here at all?
Okay, firstly, I don't agree with you that out-of-home's momentum going into COVID was lower than the rest of the market. The downturn in the economy was being seen right from July of 19 onwards, and it sort of picked up steam towards November, December, and Jan, Feb, March. And then, of course, COVID happened. So overall, there was some kind of a slowdown, but I don't think out of home slowed more than the rest of the market. Digital was the only exception because that was growing more aggressively. But if I have to compare it with TV, print, radio, cinema, all of these, it was probably not really at any disadvantage. In fact, out of home has been one of those, you know, I did a recent thing for some of these webinars, only I did one analysis, and I looked at AdX from mid-80s when I was, you know, started working kind of thing to now. And I realized that the share of out of home was about same 6-7% in 85-86, and the same around 5-6% in 2019. So it's one of those crazy ones which has just about held its own pretty much in very silently, without making too much noise about it, but it seemed to be a reasonably important, you know, it's also not a kind of medium which is a standalone medium. So it's very rare that a client will only come in with a out of home only plan. But there are some categories, auto, entertainment, finance, number of education, well, education to some extent, but retail, you know, many of these, whenever they have to come out with a campaign, it's absolutely imperative to also support whatever TV print, whatever they're doing with an outdoor campaign. So I think right now, whatever dip you're seeing is only been a COVID impact. And in this particular one also, it is the COVID impact, what we've seen has been much more accentuated in the main metro markets. So this, look, as it turns out, and we know that the out of home sort of market is actually concentrated in the metro. So Bombay, Delhi, Bangalore, and some of the other main metros, Chennai, before the entire out of home thing sort of vanished out there. So these 3-4 markets was really concentrating a good 50-60% plus of the entire ADEX. And these, not surprisingly, have been the worst impacted cities in the COVID. So when these ones disappear, even when the rest of them start coming in, you don't see such a marked impact on the sort of top line or the billings of out-of-home. But the reality is that if you now start looking at most of the hinterland, and in fact, even the smaller metros and definitely the class one towns, they actually have reasonably 85-90% of the traffic which they had pre-COVID, which is currently coming up. And a large number of advertisers are right now coming back. I think you are going to see the major blip in out of home when Bombay, Delhi and Bangalore, when they open up and the confidence of this comes up. And even right now, I was looking at some of our traffic count data that we generate. And I'm seeing that right now, if from pre-COVID period, I think we already are at about, even in a city like Bombay, we have the traffic counts for some of the key sort of arterial roads and all is maybe now 50 or 60% pre-COVID, which is, and obviously it would have gone down maybe 90% down versus pre-COVID during the complete lockdown period.
And my last question to you would be that what is your plan for the next 5 years for yourself and for Madison as well? Because the previous 5 have been spectacular. You have got great growth. You have done some of the good creative campaigns, some of good data analysis going on at Madison. What's ahead?
Oh, wow. Now you make me think. Yeah. Okay. From a Madison standpoint, 3 broad areas which I'd like to go forward in. Look, one thing, a few months back, we started putting against Madison Media, we started putting a little byline below that. We're saying Madison Media, audiences, outcomes, integrity. These 3 words. I'm going to make sure that our practice really grows very, very strongly around these 3 pivots: audiences, outcomes, and integrity. Second is, right now we have a very credible practice across the various marketing disciplines of TV, print, radio, cinema, display, video, social search, performance, out of home, activation, influencers, content. We've got, you know, all of these. Rural, all of them, we've got a pretty good retail, or we've got some very credible practices. My game is to take this expertise to best in class. The third one, I know it sounds a little flighty, but I would like it if at a managerial level, we can take our talent to move from being, as far as clients are concerned, moving them from domain experts to trusted advisors.
So all the best for your plans. And I hope when I talk to you in the next 5 years, you have more bigger things planned and more bigger things achieved. And I'm not saying that I'll talk to you 5 years later. We'll keep talking during that as well. Thank you so much for joining us here today, Vikram.
No, Mansi, thank you. It's been an absolute pleasure. Great talking to you.
Thank you.